Well, friends, it's really a great pleasure for me to be here. I'm seeing this institute for the first time, and it's really shaping very beautifully. It's also very nice to see the sort of very bright young faculty out here. And I think I'm very happy about this workshop and the way it's gone. Judging from the student talks and the feedback and the enthusiasm, etc., it's really been a great success. So I just want to congratulate the organizers and thank them for having me here. We've heard a lot about fluids. I want to talk also about fluids, but a slightly different kind of fluid, which is a granular fluid. I mean, all of us who walked on the beach know that sand, well, if you kick a pile of sand, it hurts. So that's solid-like behavior. If, on the other hand, you pour sand, it pours like water, for example, okay? So granular matter has properties of fluids, has properties of solids, and properties intermediate to both of those, okay? And I hope there's been a lot of interest in granular matter in the last 20, 30 years amongst physicists, and I want to sort of just convey to you some of the reason for that interest and some of the sort of exciting problems people have been looking at, okay? So the title is Cooling in Granular Gases. I'll be looking at a dilute granular fluid, and by cooling, I basically mean the following. The system has inelastic, the grains undergo inelastic collisions, which make it lose kinetic energy. And the kinetic energy loss is what's referred to as the cooling, because you typically associate in kinetic theory the temperature with the average kinetic energy. Okay, so having said that, let me just sort of move on to my overview. I'll start off with a brief introduction. Yeah. Dilute, I will make it more specific, but let's say typically 0.2 volume fraction is a dilute gas, okay? I typically don't want to be in a situation where I have three particle, four particle collisions. At most, I have two particle collisions, okay? That's what is important. At the end, I'll also refer to dense granular media, but that'll come later, okay? Okay, so I'll start off with an introduction to this sort of problem. I will then start talking about granular gases, and in part B, I will focus on granular gases whose restitution coefficient of collision is a constant. Okay, it undergoes an inelastic collision with a constant restitution coefficient. In part C, I'll talk about what are called viscoelastic granular gases, and in viscoelastic granular gases, the restitution coefficient, again, it's going to be inelastic collisions between the grains, but the restitution coefficient will now depend on the normal velocity of collision, okay? So that's sort of a physically more realistic system. I don't know whether how much time I'll get, but briefly maybe I'll mention frictional cooling of granular gases. So in this case, you'll have cooling because of friction between two particles rubbing against each other. And then finally, I'll end with the customary conclusion, okay? So that's the plan of the talk. Okay, so as I've already made some of these statements, but let me sort of emphasize them again. Granular matter or powders are ubiquitous, and examples, of course, are sand, glass beads, ball bearings, medicine capsules, and so on and so forth. These are obviously systems of great interest. And for our purpose, they are large thermodynamic assemblies of inelastic particles, okay? So you can think of a sand dune as a thermodynamic assembly of sand grains, basically, okay? The typical size of these particles ranges from microns to a centimeter. You can think of the rings of Saturn as being composed of granular matter. That's the kind of model people write down, as a matter of fact. So in that case, you can have large particles. Or typically, if you're looking at grains of sand, they're in the micron range. Okay, for my purpose, the most important property of granular matter is that the particles dissipate energy on collision. They undergo inelastic collisions, okay? A lot of people, including in India, people like Deepak Dhar, etc., have worried about static properties of granular matter. The sorts of questions you ask there is, if you have a sand pile, what determines its angle of repose? What is the stress distribution in the sand pile, and so on and so forth, okay? But I'm interested in dynamical properties of granular matter. So for my purpose, the most important property is that the particles dissipate energy on collision or undergo cooling. I'm interested in a system where the scale of the assembly is much larger than the particle size. So that's kind of a thermodynamic limit. But I already sort of provide a caveat out here that because of the large size of the particles, various properties depend upon the shape and size of the particle. Okay? So it's, I mean, for example, piles of rice will be different from piles of spherical grains of sand. Okay, they'll differ in various ways. Or medicine capsules will behave differently from ball bearings, for example. Yeah, please. It's an idealization which we've studied from school onwards, basically, right? And a lot of physics is premised on elastic collisions, but you actually don't have elastic collisions, yeah. Okay, so as I said, various properties are going to depend upon the shape and size of the particle. So there's less universality at the macro level, at the sort of everyday experience level. But nevertheless, as a physicist, I want to identify points of universal behavior. Okay, so I'm still going to target the universality that exists, but I be clear that lots of stuff will depend upon the precise nature and of the microscopic particles. Unlike usual statistical physics, where you don't really worry about the shape of atoms or molecules and so on and so forth. Okay, as I said, this problem has been of interest to the engineering community for hundreds of years, literally. Last few decades, it's also been of great interest to physicists. An early influential article was this one by Sid Nagel at Chicago. Beringer is at Duke, and they wrote this Reviews of Modern Physics about 20 years ago. Another interesting place where you can understand the sort of status of the granular research is these powders and grains conference proceedings. And then I've also been following this book, particularly for granular gases, this book by Brilliantov and Poschel. Later on, I'll actually describe some work we've done together with Brilliantov also. Okay, so that book's called The Kinetic Theory of Granular Gases. Okay, as I said, I'm interested in dynamical problems for granular matter. So I'm interested in inelastic particles which undergo inelastic collisions, okay? So there's two classes of dynamical problems one might look at, what people do look at. In the first class, you continuously input energy to compensate the energy lost due to the inelastic collisions, okay? So thereby the system enters a non-equilibrium steady state, and you try to describe the pattern dynamics of the system in the non-equilibrium steady state, okay? And most of the ways of thermostating granular matter or energizing granular matter are dictated by engineering applications. You could rotate it in a drum, or you could rotate granular matter in a drum, as we do on a construction site, typically, where you sort of mix sand and cement or some such thing. You could vertically or horizontally vibrate granular matter. I like to call this one my grandmother's experiment. My grandmother used to vibrate wheat to separate the wheat from the chaff, right? That's an example of a granular experiment. The system enters a non-equilibrium steady state, and one is interested in the properties of that non-equilibrium steady state. You can flow granular matter, you can pour it, and so on and so forth, okay? I will not focus on this class of problems, though they are also of great interest. I'm going to actually focus on a much simpler problem. Well, not so simple as a matter of fact, but on the rather different problem. I consider an initially homogeneous granular gas, which is evolving without any drive. There's no external drive, okay? The grains undergo inelastic collisions, they lose kinetic energy, and finally the system is going to die, right? You know that. What does it do in the process of getting to death? You'll find there'll be very interesting pattern dynamics and growth laws, etc., emerging from that system. Okay, if you want an example in the back of your mind, you can think of interstellar dust. The early universe consisted of interstellar dust, okay, homogeneous interstellar dust, and then by some mechanism, it aggregated into galaxies and stars and planets and so on and so forth. Okay, so just keep that system in the back of your mind. You have this homogeneous interstellar dust evolving via inelastic collisions. What happens to this system as time goes on? Okay, so that's the non-equilibrium stat-mech problem I'm going to consider in this talk. This is a problem people have looked at for a while. An early famous paper is due to Hoff in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics. Another very nice paper is due to Goldhirsch and Zanetti. This was in PRL long time ago, and this continues to be a system of great interest. Okay, so here's my freely, yeah, please. Absolutely, absolutely. We'll discuss that also, okay? But for the moment, let's just think of a situation where there's no gravity, okay? Okay, so here's my example of a freely evolving granular gas. Here's a typical example of a granular collision. Particle I comes in from here, particle J comes in from here. They undergo an inelastic collision in which the normal component of the velocity is dissipated and thereby come out a little more parallel to each other than when they went in, okay? So that's the typical granular collision. How do you get the collision rule? This is what I call a Resnick and Halliday level problem. You conserve the momentum and you dissipate some of the normal velocity at collision. It's very easy to write down the sort of collision rule. These are the velocities after the collision, and Vi and Vj are the velocities before the collision. N vector is the unit vector at the point of collision. So this whole thing is the normal relative velocity which is being dissipated. Okay, and this is, as I said, it's sort of a IIT entrance exam level of question. The important quantity out here is this quantity E, which is the restitution coefficient of collision. Okay, and the restitution coefficient of collision for an elastic collision is E equal to 1. For inelastic collisions, E is less than 1 and greater than 0, okay? So depending on how inelastic the collision is, these particles will be parallelized after collision. If E is equal to 0, that's called the sticky gas limit. The particles just sort of come out totally parallel to each other. They entirely dissipate the normal component of the velocity, okay? So as you can imagine, this particle, so these two parallelize, this guy goes and collides with somebody else out there, there's a local parallelization. This collides with something else out there. There's a local parallelization and so on and so forth. What is the physics of the process? Firstly, obviously, the density and momentum are conserved during the collision. The density is two particles go in, two particles come out. The momentum, that's one of the ingredients I use to obtain this sort of collision rule. So these two quantities are conserved. But the magnitude of the normal velocity is reduced when E is less than 1. Okay, and that basically means that there is a loss of kinetic energy in the system. And this loss of kinetic energy is sort of encapsulated by this half cooling law. And the half cooling law, which I'm going to derive on my next slide, is the statement that the temperature goes with time as this law. So basically, the temperature goes with time. Maybe I'll just write this down on the board. So for the half cooling law, the temperature goes down with time. The temperature goes down with time as T raised to the power minus 2. And that's actually rather straightforward to derive. I'll derive it on the next sort of slide. But I just want to say, as non-equilibrium stat mech, one tries to sort of nail power laws or other laws of various time-dependent behaviors. Okay, that's one of the sort of standard approaches of a non-equilibrium physicist. Okay, the second thing that's happening here is that the kinetic energy is going down, the system is cooling. The velocities are also parallelizing, and correlations are starting to build up in the velocity field, okay? And a lot of the physics that arises will be due to these correlations building up, okay? And we'll see some of that as we go along. Okay, so here's a derivation of the half cooling law. It's very sort of straightforward. You consider two particles colliding. You find the initial energy. You find the final energy. Subtract the two. Get the change of energy. And then just average over all directions of collision, basically. So the only assumption that's gone into it is that the system is homogeneous. So here's, it's very easy to find that the fraction of the energy lost per collision is 1 minus E squared. So if E is equal to 1, or you are in the elastic limit, this is just 0, as you expect. So 1 minus E squared is what I call epsilon. And D is the dimensionality. The dimensionality comes in because you lose energy in one dimension and don't lose it in the other D minus one dimensions, basically. Okay, so that's where the dimensionality comes into the picture. Okay, how do you get the cooling law? As I said, thermal temperature is not meaningful for granular particles. They're too large to care about 200 degrees or 300 degrees Kelvin. So you define the temperature in analogy with kinetic theory as the average kinetic energy. The loss of average kinetic energy is a minus sign because it's cooling. This fraction, epsilon by D, the frequency of collision at a certain temperature, T, times the temperature. And again, you take an expression from kinetic theory for the frequency of collision. Don't worry about these prefactors. This is basically the density of the granular gas. The more dense it is, the more the frequency of collision. But the important factor here is the square root of temperature. This is just the inverse of the mean free path, basically. Okay? So that's, you sort of plug that into there, do the integral, and you obtain the half cooling law, which is that temperature goes with time as so. It's always nice to refer back to the elastic limit and sort of make sure that things are working in the elastic limit. In the elastic limit, E is equal to 1, epsilon is equal to 0. Epsilon is equal to 0 here, this term drops out. And as you expect, in the elastic limit, the temperature is the same for all times. There's no loss of the kinetic energy. Okay, another concept I want to introduce at this point is the collision time. The collision time, see, the system is cooling. The mean squared velocity is going down, so the system is becoming more sluggish with time. Okay, it's going to take longer and longer time between collisions as time proceeds. Okay, so the collision time is the number of collisions a particle has undergone on average up to time t. That's just the integral of the frequency of collision. And again, if you do this integral, you find that the collision time goes logarithmically with the real time. Okay, so the system is becoming more sluggish. The time between collisions is increasing with the as you go later into the cooling process. Okay, how do you get back to the elastic limit? Always nice to go to the elastic limit. E equal to 1, epsilon is 0. You Taylor expand log 1 plus z. 2d by epsilon will cancel with that epsilon by 2d. And the collision time is proportional to the real time in the elastic limit, as you expect, because the mean squared velocity or the temperature is constant with time. Okay. A particularly nice thing about this collision time is that the Haas law takes a very simple form in this collision time language. And the Haas law simply takes the following form. T as a function of the temperature as a function of the collision time is the initial temperature E raised to the power minus epsilon by D tau. So it's just exponential in collision time, okay? It's an exponential decay in collision time. Remember, the only approximation, the only assumption that has gone into this simple derivation, this is Haas derivation, is that of homogeneity, okay? So if the system is homogeneous, Haas cooling law seems to be valid. Let's test it. This is something we've done a long time ago. We've done large-scale event-driven simulations, molecular simulations of the system. Here's a typical result. So I'm plotting the temperature on this axis. I'm plotting the collision time on this axis. And I'm plotting it on a semi-log scale. Okay? On this semi-log scale, the Haas law should just be a straight line decaying like that. Okay? What sort of results do we get? Let's mull on these results for a bit. Okay? At E equal to 1, which is the elastic limit, I haven't shown that data out here, the temperature is just a constant for all time, right? That's the elastic limit. Now you turn on the inelasticity. Let's consider E equal to 0.95. That's the sort of dark circles out here. And this straight line is the corresponding Haas law. Initially, my data follows the Haas law. And then it deviates. There's a crossover to a different regime, okay? This is something that's not, I have to understand next, okay? But I've labeled this as the homogeneous cooling state where the Haas law applies. And the latter regime is something I will show you in the next transparency where the system becomes inhomogeneous. So it continues to cool, but now there are density inhomogeneities. And that's what I call the inhomogeneous cooling state, okay? As you increase the inelasticity, the initial decay becomes faster. And then there's a faster crossover to a inhomogeneous state. Okay, so the crossover from the initial half regime to the asymptotic inhomogeneous regime is earlier, and so on and so forth. So that's the picture. Initially, the Haas law works. That's just following the straight line out here. And then you have a sort of later regime, which is different, which is what I want to next understand. So here's a picture of my molecular dynamic simulations of this granular gas. I start off with a homogeneous granular gas, like I have interstellar dust, right, basically. So at time t equal to zero, somewhere up there, I start off with a homogeneous granular gas. At 10 collisions per particle, it's approximately homogeneous. As time goes on, I start to see spontaneous emergence of density inhomogeneities, okay? And as time goes on, these clusters grow, and you coarsen into regions which are rich in particles or dense in particles and poor in particles, which are the white regions out here, basically, okay? I want to emphasize that this clustering is spontaneous. Another sort of system where this happens a lot is phase separation of, let's say, oil and water mixtures. But in oil and water mixtures, they phase separate because oil and water have surface tension between them. In this case, they are phase separating spontaneously, and the sort of surface tension in quotes is effectively generated by this kinetic collision. Okay, you can also look at the velocity field. When you look at the fluid, you're also interested in the velocity field. At early times, there's no structure in the velocity fields. At late times, you see the emergence of vortices and anti-vortices. These vortices and anti-vortices sort of collide with each other. You get larger and larger regions which are parallelized locally, or sort of clusters traveling in the same direction. And this coarsening process also continues. Again, it's driven by inelasticity of the collision. Yes. This is in 2D, but you can get the same result in 3D. And in 3D, the sort of defects which normally drive the velocity field are monopoles rather than sort of vortices. But the same picture applies, basically. Yeah.
Yeah. So when I look at the large time density.
Yeah.
So superficially, visually, it appears that you get these caustic formations and the effect. So are they the superficial, or I think if I do a field calculation,
yeah,
I really get multi-valued.
You get multi-value fourth place portraits, as a matter of fact. But I was just going to remark that I'm using the term interstellar dust. If you've seen pictures of clustering of early galaxies, that's the picture you see essentially in the textbook, basically. Okay, so that's where the sort of analogy comes with. Okay, I think in my last, I have about 10 minutes. Yeah, please. Sorry? So you're getting clusters which are growing with time. Well, because there's a density fluctuation. The density fluctuation grows. Sorry, I forgot. I forgot to tell you the physics reason for the growth of density clusters. If there's a density inhomogeneity, you have regions which are more dense, regions which are less dense. The regions which are more dense have faster collisions, so they cool faster. The pressure goes down faster, and they suck particles from neighboring sites into that region. Okay, so this is something that's called a negative diffusion instability. Normally, diffusion tries to smooth out a field. In this case, diffusion actually builds up the inhomogeneities with time. Okay, so these are typically clusters that you should think of, and the clusters are growing with time as they suck more and more particles from the neighboring regions into them. Yeah. Well, I mean, the composition dictates the morphology to a certain extent. Okay? Because remember, you are conserving the amount of granular matter in this system. So if you have a different composition, well, the morphology is usually this sort of intergalactic sort of galaxy-type structure usually, okay? But we can discuss that. I mean, the morphology has to do with the sort of composition of the mixture. Okay, so far I have been discussing the case of constant E constant restitution coefficient. And so far, I haven't told you anything about the sort of analytical tools we apply to this problem. Let me do that in the context of part C of my talk, which is, I think I have approximately 10 minutes. So let me just use my last 10 minutes for that. As I said, so this is actually work done with Avdesh Dubey, who was, I think, here yesterday, and also Brilliantov and a Russian student from Moscow. And now we are going to consider viscoelastic granular gases. In viscoelastic granular gases, I have exactly the same sort of cartoon picture. Particle I comes in, particle J comes in. They sort of collide with each other, and then they come out a little more parallel to each other. In this case, the constant E is low. This restitution coefficient E is not a constant, but rather depends on the normal velocity of collision. Okay, and this is a problem a lot of people have worried about, and I think it's just sort of appropriate to mention that one of the first guys who worried about this was Raman. Raman actually did experiments at ISC where he collided steel balls and wooden balls and tried to figure out how the mechanism of dissipation is that the particles deform. They deform and then they sort of vibrate and radiate their energy away, basically. Okay, so at low normal velocities of collision, you don't have deformation, hence the collision is approximately elastic, okay? So I'm going to take an expression for E from our collaborators. Lots of people have calculated how E depends on the normal velocity. The precise form of the function doesn't matter, but E is 1, which is the elastic limit, minus something. So it's a Taylor series in the normal velocity, basically, okay? And as the normal velocity goes to 0, this goes to the collisions start to become elastic, okay? And this is a big difference from the previous problem. Okay, now I want to sort of also say something about how we analytically deal with such problems, because we've also done a lot of analytical work on these problems. The typical starting point, we want to develop an inelastic kinetic theory for a granular gas, and there's sort of two ingredients that go into it. The first ingredient is this well-known Boltzmann transport equation, which I think the students would have got in their advanced statistical mechanics course, okay? So the Boltzmann transport equation is premised on two-body collisions, hence it's only valid for a gas, what I call a gas. And I'm not going to go into the details of this, but sort of the important part aspect of it is this collision integral out here. I hope people have studied this in their sort of in their courses, and the collision integral relates ingoing and outgoing velocities of the two particles undergoing the collision. Okay, how do you go for the inelastic version of that? You replace this one, this E, which is 1 in the elastic Boltzmann equation, by its corresponding counterpart for the granular gas, okay? So that's the first sort of ingredient in my inelastic kinetic theory. I'm giving it in sort of just in words, but this material is available in the literature, and that book sort of details how it works quite well, okay? The second ingredient is some sort of reasonable ansatz for this probability distribution. What is a reasonable ansatz for the probability distribution? Again, it's nice to refer back to the elastic limit. In the elastic limit, if you start off a bunch of particles, elastic particles, within a few collisions, the Boltzmann transport equation tells you that they will collapse to a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, right? So that's the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. This is something we all are very familiar with. This is the mean squared velocity, and that's the usual sort of Gaussian term, basically. So for the granular gas, the appropriate ansatz is, one, we replace this V0 squared by a time-dependent V0 squared, okay? Because the system is now cooling with time, so the mean squared velocity is coming down with time. And we generalize this exponential by a function F, which is some expansion in a complete set, and our fluid mechanics friends usually use what are called Sonnin polynomials for this expansion. Again, I don't want to sort of go too much into details into that. The leading term of this expansion is the Maxwell-Boltzmann term. And departures from Maxwell-Boltzmann-ness are captured by these Sonnin coefficients. Okay, so what you have to keep in the back of your mind is that when the Sonnin coefficients become different from zero, you are starting to see the non-Maxwell-Boltzmann nature of the granular matter. I should say that one of the big deals in granular matter has been to identify the velocity distributions. And as a matter of fact, the velocity distributions usually depend upon the particular kind of system you're looking at. You can have power law tails, you can have exponentials, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this is a situation for which we've been able to completely capture the departure from Maxwell-Boltzmann behavior. Anyway, you plug this velocity distribution ansatz back into the Boltzmann-Enskog equation, and then sort of crank the machinery. You do have to do a truncation at some level in this Sonnin polynomial expansion. And that's basically the ingredient of our inelastic kinetic theory, okay? The first thing my inelastic kinetic theory tells me is that for the viscoelastic gas, instead of my cooling as T raised to the power minus 2, I actually cool as T raised to the power minus 5/3, okay? That's the first thing, so that comes out of my inelastic kinetic theory. So here's a plot of our molecular dynamic simulations. Here's the temperature on this axis. Here's the time. So this is now real time, it's not collision time. These are the data sets for different levels of inelasticity. That's how the system is cooling. And that's, as you see, nicely obeying this T raised to the power minus 5/3 law predicted by our inelastic kinetic theory for the viscoelastic gas. You can also look at thermostated systems. So far, we've looked at the simplest thermostat where the system is heated uniformly. So you might consider radiation is incident on your interstellar dust, and there's a uniform heating. We've again worked out the inelastic kinetic theory for that. I'm just going to show you what happens in that case. What happens is what you physically expect. That's the temperature. That's the real time in some dimensionless units. For the freely evolving case, you cool as T raised to the power minus 5/3. That's data out there. And for the heated thermostated case, you cool for a while according to that law and then settle down to some equilibrium temperature dictated by this non-equilibrium steady state. So now this is a driven system where you, when you're heating it, where you find some sort of balance between the heating, which is my thermostat or my temperature, and the sort of mean squared velocity and the temperature of the cooling gas. Let me quickly show you results for the Sonnin coefficients also. So remember the departure of the Sonnin coefficients from zero is a measure of how non Maxwell-Boltzmann the system is, okay? So for the freely evolving gas, these are the Sonnin coefficients. I've plotted A2, A3, A4, etc. The circles or the squares are our data sets. And as you can see, our inelastic kinetic theory fits rather well to the sort of A2, A3, A4, which quantify the sort of departure from Maxwell-Boltzmann. Also for the thermostated gas, we can sort of do the same calculation. In this case, ultimately, the system becomes elastic because as T goes to infinity, as time goes to infinity, the system sort of has no normal velocity and the collisions become elastic. But in this case, of course, you sort of settle down as the temperature had settled down to some constant value. Okay? Okay, I think I've taken my time. I'm sort of already 5 minutes over it. So I won't talk about our last set of things, where we've been looking at frictional cooling of granular gases. I just want to say couple of sentences about this. This is work I'm doing with my current student, Prasenjit Das, and my colleague at Tel Aviv, Moshe Schwartz. Okay, now we are addressing one of the really difficult problems in granular matter, which is how to write down a dense, a continuum theory for the dense granular material. Okay, the starting point is the Navier-Stokes equation. But how do you modify the Navier-Stokes equation to account for the specific granular effects, okay? And one of the major sort of obstacles, so one thing obviously is to provide a heat sink, okay? You're losing average V squared, okay? But you have to do other things. And one of the major complications that arises is the development of these clusters. These clusters essentially become very high density regions, and one doesn't know how to deal with these at present, okay? So our current target with Moshe and Prasenjit Das is to sort of try to write down a better continuum theory of dense granular matter. In this context, we've been looking at frictional cooling because in dense granular matter, frictional cooling is much more important. There are hardly any collisions taking place, right? The particles are rubbing against each other. But that's going to have to be discussed on another occasion. Again, we get similar clustering and so on and so forth in this system, okay? And again, you can associate various growth laws and decay laws with the temperature as a function of time, and we can actually calculate the various laws that apply to the various time-dependent regimes. Okay, that brings me to my conclusion. So I've sort of given you a half an hour survey of granular gases, which is a system of lot of interest to non-equilibrium physicists. And we've looked at granular gases with inelastic collisions, where the restitution coefficient E is constant. And we've also considered a case where E depends on the normal velocity of collision. The velocity distributions are non-Maxwellian in both cases, and we can quantify these via the inelastic Boltzmann equation. Okay, so we've done all those calculations. We've also included heating that is a uniform thermostat in these systems. And again, we can sort of work out the necessary inelastic kinetic theory. Okay, at early stages, there's a homogeneous cooling state. Then there's a spontaneous density clustering and velocity field clustering. And you go into what's called the inhomogeneous cooling state. Again, we've also, well, I didn't really discuss this. We've looked at granular gases with friction. The sort of next directions we are going to is the following. The first is it's important to introduce, so far we've looked at homogeneous heating. The entire granular gas is heated uniformly. But it's important to go for a situation where you have space-dependent heating. Because in most engineering situations, in my grandmother's experiment, the granular material was being heated from the surface, right? Because the collisions were taking place at the surface. In the rotating drum, the material is being heated from the, it's being thermostated from the boundary of the drum, okay? So our next sort of target is to consider space-dependent heating for granular gases. For example, as I said, from vibrating plate or rotating drum. And the second set of things which we are targeting is a better, but this is of course more ambitious, but we're targeting a better sort of theory of dense granular matter, a better continuum theory of dense granular matter. Here we have to deal with all sorts of complicating factors, like there are multiple grain collisions. 20 particles could be in contact at the same time. They would be in prolonged contact. They would be rubbing against each other. Clusters would form, which we have to understand how to deal with in our continuum theory, and so on and so forth, okay? So this is something I'll report on, hopefully the next time I'm here. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Right.
That's why it kind of becomes constant.
Right. So the we understand the asymptotic growth law, the cooling law also. I should have said that in the ICS you cool as tau, which is the collision time raised to power minus dimensionality by 2. Okay, so it's a bit slower cooling than in the homogeneous state. And you're perfectly right, particles sort of stream across free space ballistically and join a cluster. And I mean, we're not the only ones who've studied this. Kripivsky and Benheim have studied it. There's actually been lots of calculations and some controversy about the growth laws, about the cooling laws which characterize the inhomogeneous state.
Yeah.
It would matter. It would matter, as a matter of fact, yeah. It would matter. This filamentary structure, as I said, is, I mean, when we look at the frictional gases cooling, you don't get the filamentary structure anymore, okay? So I didn't show you this picture, but when you look at the cooling by friction, you get more blob-like structures which are reminiscent of phase separation of oil and water mixtures. These filamentary structures are unique to the inelastic restitution coefficient version of cooling, basically, okay? But the density instability is for the same reason, that cooler regions have lower pressure and then they suck the particles in. Please, please. Yeah.
Is this the pressure analysis in the case of
Well, just as a rough approximation, think of an ideal gas. I mean, for a point of reference, PV is equal to nRT, right? So when T decreases, P decreases. And that's why you suck particles in to dense regions. No, it doesn't occur in the governing equations. As a matter of fact, it would be this is a highly non-equilibrium system, so it would be difficult to write down an equation of state for this system, basically, right? It's you're sort of losing energy, and I mean, all sorts of things are going on. Even entropy is difficult to define in this case, huh? But as I said, roughly, if you think of the gas analogy, you expect the temperature to go down and the pressure to go down correspondingly. Yeah. In case of elastic collision, if you look, so generally it's logarithmic. In the case of elastic collision, epsilon is going to zero. Log 1 plus z is just z. And then this 2d by epsilon cancels this epsilon by 2d. So the collision time is proportional to real time, as you expect. In four elastic collisions, yeah. For inelastic collisions, it goes logarithmically with the time. The system becomes more sluggish because the mean squared velocity diminishes and the time between collisions becomes larger and larger. Why? I mean, the system is cooling with time, right? What is the typical mean free collision time? That's what I said. For the elastic collisions, the collision time goes proportional to the real time. It goes linearly with the real time, yeah. And that's there in this logarithmic expression. If you just sort of Taylor expand this this log. I'm sorry, I've not answered the question, huh?
Yeah, because elastic means energy is conserved, right?
Elastic means energy is conserved. Inelastic means kinetic energy is dissipated.
It is.
That's exactly what I'm saying. For elastic collisions, E is 1. Epsilon is 0. Log 1 plus Z is Z. 2D by epsilon cancels that. So for elastic collisions, tau goes linearly with time, as per your expectations. You're right, yeah. Okay. Please. Dilute granular matter. It's not valid when you go to the dense limit. Well, I think it's there's a little history in this, and the history is that traditionally you target the velocity distributions. Okay, as I said, one of the big deals of granular matter is what is the velocity distribution in a particular system. And the most natural framework in which to understand the velocity distribution is the Boltzmann equation. As I said, so for example, in the elastic collisions, let me just get back to my transport equation. In the elastic Boltzmann equation, which one studies in one's advanced StatMed course, one knows that if you start off with any random velocity distribution of elastic particles, within a few collisions, they relax to Maxwell-Boltzmann. That's your reference point. Obviously, built into this is the fact that they are not multiple collisions. Built into this is the fact that it's not extremely inelastic. I'm not looking at E equal to 0 in my calculations. I'm looking at E equal to 0.95, 0.9, and so on and so forth. So I'm perturbing around the elastic limit. One should be clear of where this inelastic Boltzmann equation works, I think, yeah. Absolutely not.
In that case, do you really for this PDE problem?
That's what I was emphasizing, that one would like to have a good continuum description in terms of a velocity field, in terms of a density field, etc. Again, the starting point one would be a Navier-Stokes equation. But what do you, how do you modify the Navier-Stokes equation? Okay, and one of the unpleasant things that happens in granular matter is aggregation, which I've been discussing in this. So these plugs become very high density clusters are the plugs. How do you sort of deal with these plugs in a continuum theory? That's the outstanding question, basically.
But if you see that there's a thermoviscoelastic equation,
yeah. Berlin, the Berlin group, huh?
Alexander Milke is a big man. Mm. That work. So, I don't know. I was just asking that if you really go for the dense one, that could possibly those kind of things necessary.
I can look at the papers, but yeah, I'm not aware of that work. And this is considered one of the major problems in the area.
They've started very recently because they're all looking.
I see.
When you actually you heat it, you know, already the thermal viscoelasticity and thermal will come and then wake up the system of heat.
But do they account for, do they form clusters in their systems? I mean, if you have granular matter in a hopper, you know, that this is an industrial application, then the hopper gets jammed after a while because of this formation of these knots. How do you describe that? It's the same question as I'm asking in this simpler context, basically. So as long as you're just working with the Navier-Stokes supplemented with the heat sink and all that, you're fine. But you can't describe that regime where the hopper gets jammed. I mean, what happens is two plugs form a bridge and no more flow of grain or whatever you're putting through the hopper, basically. How do you deal with that? That's a question, yeah.
Which is in those pictures that we take from the
photo. Yeah.
So when you look at these lines, this thing, so when you were talking about this interstellar dust, etc., if I take the Zeldovich sort of approximation to a continuum equation, so it's two dimensional, and that's exactly the sort of picture one gets. The reason I'm making this analogy, I mean, slightly more concrete, because of falling reason. So I can go to the implicit limit where I can write down a Lagrangian map for the two-dimensional Zeldovich with the Zeldovich approximation.
Yeah.
So I'm essentially describing particle dynamics, but through a continuum. I mean, we're talking
Colliding shocks, basically.
And then you get these line aggregates. What's more interesting is, you know, when I was looking at the half stop, so if you calculate the temperature, if I define the temperature in the way you do, so U squared, let's say, continuum field, you get exactly the same T minus 2 cooling law from the Burgers.
From the Burgers equation.
And then you also get a minus 5/3 cooling law. I can't remember, it's 7/3 or 5/3 to check. In an approximation where you tinker around with the viscosity.
Oh, that's to, I see.
To sort of fine-tune this collision of shocks.
I see.
So
that's very interesting, huh? If I recollect correctly, Karpivsky and Ben Naim, they haven't worked on the viscoelastic case, but they worked on the constant restitution case and drawn some analogy with the Burgers equation.
Yeah, I actually should. Need those
papers. This is what also, I don't know whether you know Rajesh and the Biendu, also, right, so, yeah.
And now when you put in also particles for this affecting compressibility, then you probably
right.
So you do get these points of divergence where the lines point towards, you know, you have these line defects.
Yeah.
And so that morphology comes out and it sort of matches very well with the Gary-Body simulation and also these.
I think it's no, the connection is clearly an important one, I think. Because you can think of these, I mean, at a very naive level, these interfaces are like shocks moving around, basically.
And then one of the, again, was working on these sort of trying to map these line defects on the 2D burgers using faces to see how well it marries with these N-body simulations. So maybe I can show you.
Well, I think that would be very interesting. That would be very interesting. That would be very interesting.
I see.
And we should also look at this Kripovsky bednaim, because I'm not a...
Even in elastic collapse, you get a critical coefficient.
Right. But for the viscoelastic case, the inelastic collapse goes away.
Exactly.
Because once the velocity becomes small enough, the collisions become elastic, basically. This is a problem, as a matter of fact, with the E constant case, you get an inelastic collapse, basically. Yeah. Multiple collisions in a finite time, basically.